This actual property, I don't live on, my daughters live on, but we've had this property for about 15 years. The problem we have here is the spruce budworm came through here and knocked out just about all the balsam and a lot of the spruce. It created a really big fire hazard. So we are trying to change the habitat back to what originally was and to reduce fire hazard. What we do is we go in with chainsaws and we cut down all the dead balsams and spruce trees around all these pines and aspen and all the other trees. We'll go a little bit at a time and cut it down. We cut it in pieces, and then I have a skidder with a rake on it that we push into a pile, and we'll burn as we're going. We'll start a small fire and just keep feeding it. NRCS has been really good to work for. I've had three cost shares. They've been really good because they've broken the 15 acres up into 5 acres a year so we can manage it, because we're also replanting and caging at the same time. The first one was 15 acres, and that was a cost share for the balsam removal. The second one was another 15 acres for more balsam removal. And the third one's 15 acres also, and we're 5 acres into that. In the northern part of the property will be the other 15, 20 acres of cost share, and that gets into more of a scattered white pine stand where we're clearing out and trying to expand the white pines and the older generation for like cedar trees. There's two creeks that come together on this property, and they'll run into a river. On both sides of the creek is mostly white pines, and that's where we're trying to regenerate and expand it. I'm a big time white pine guy. I just love white pines. I plant the white pines basically because I want to make sure some seed in there, but I do get a lot of natural regen of white pines. This is along the Lake Superior, so I have a lot of trouble with deer. Unfortunately, when you get natural regen, you also get deer. I don't want a monoculture. I don't want it to look like a plantation. So I try to plant enough white pines in there to make it look more of a natural forest. I've gotten a lot of bur oak regen, which is really nice. I really like bur oak. And I've gotten some spruce regen and a little bit of birch. In NRCS, I've had a really good work relationship with Jonathan Selno and especially Gail Bong. They've been very helpful. They've come out here. They've advised me in a lot. And they've been very good to work with. The NRCS did a lot for me with cost share, because this big of a project is financially really difficult to do this by yourself. So they've helped a lot on the cost share. They've also come out and made sure I flagged everything so I knew where I was, so I didn't go on other people's land. They were the ones that advised me to split the cost share into pieces, because you get a little carried away or you think you can do more than you really can. So they've given me advice like that, and they've also given me advice on tree species in certain areas.
So when you did this project, what program did you sign up under?
This is under the NRCS Equip program. They'll cost share if you wanted to do it yourself like I do, and it helps me with the costs for chainsaws and operations, and it helps me operate my skidder, or you could use it as a partial payment to hire somebody else to do it if you're unable to do it yourself. This square right here is 5 acres out of the 15-acre equip cost share I've got starting in 2019. We're trying to expand the white pine stand, basically. So we're following the edge of the white pines and in the white pines and taking out the dead balsams and stuff. The NRCS, like I said, have been really good to work for, and they do have a lot of different programs. It seems sort of overwhelming when you first talk to them, because they do have so much stuff. But they help you go through all the ins and outs of the stuff, so you're not buried trying to fill out paperwork and all that stuff. I haven't had any difficulties at all. It's been no problem whatsoever as far as working with the NRCS.
What I'm seeing, what you did here, Jim, is it looks beautiful. You mitigated the spruce budworm issue by cutting a lot of your balsam fir out, but there's also a lot of side benefits you're going to get from this. In general, a lot of people think the timber that you're cutting, you're going to have less volume because you're removing timber, but what actually is the total opposite. Because what's happening when you have high density, high BA, all the trees are competing against each other and using all its energy just to stay alive. But now that you've opened up your stand, all those trees are going to use its energy now just to grow bigger. It's going to have more DBH in the long run, and overall your mortality rate is going to go down. I'm really happy to see that you don't have a monoculture here. You have a high diversity of different species, which is also going to increase your overall stand health and vigor. You know, because if you have more of a dominant species growing in one place, and then a disease like spruce budworm comes in, and if someone, all they have is balsam fir, there goes their whole stand. How you have it set up here looks really good and really healthy and for the long run.
Thanks. When you're doing this type of clearing, you have to go by what Mother Nature will allow you to do. If you get a real wet time of the year, you do your high ground. In the winter time, if it's froze, you can hit your low ground. And these plants are sort of set up that way that they can help you out in that kind of thing. When you have a real heavy, thick stand of balsam, absolutely nothing grows underneath them. But when I took those balsam out, it opened up the sunlight to the ground, and I'm seeing a lot of different types of flowers and stuff, especially in the spring. And like in the fall, I get asters and stuff. It has changed it. I basically base my what I left as far as aspen trees go on how much sun it would let in, because when you've got white pines with all the problems they have with white pine weevil and blister rust, if you let in too much sun, then you can get your weevils. The overstory actually protects them from white pine blister rust. And another thing, if you open it up too much, there's certain areas I took out too many for firewood. And if you open it up too much, you get a lot of grass, and that grass chokes everything out. So I try to leave enough aspen for overstory. I want to plant under the overstory. The trees are planted are mostly white pine, but along the river I planted some resistant American elm, because I'm trying to reestablish American elm that were here that have died off because of the Dutch elm disease. I generally try to shoot for 500 to 600 trees every year, because I try to clear 5 acres a year and I put 100 trees per acre.
And Jim, you make all these cages yourself?
I do. Yeah, keeps me out of my wife's hair all winter. We use poultry netting and fiberglass rebar. It's 4-foot netting, but as the trees grow, I just slide the netting up the rebar, so it's pretty cost effective. That's about as cheap as I could figure out how to do it. That's a white pine. I just planted that a few weeks ago. That's actually a containerized stock. I'll plant bare root stock from the state of Minnesota a lot. In the fall, you can buy containerized stock through the private greenhouses, so I bought some containerized stock to plant these. White pines have had sort of a tough road to hoe with all the logging and the fires and the deer and the diseases. And to me, they're just a beautiful tree. They're really quality wood. I love the looks of them. They all look a little different, you know. I love red pines too, and other trees too, but red pines all look alike, and white pines all have sort of a different personality. And they've got the 5 needles, so I like the sound of them, the wind blowing through a white pine. But I've also planted bur oak. I plant cedar trees in the lower areas. I've planted yellow birch along the river in the sandy loam areas. I've planted tamarack and black spruce in the lower areas. I've even planted some red pine, but red pine's a little tricky in this area because of the red clay. When I look at a piece of property, I say, that tree's growing good here. It's sort of a no-brainer to plant that tree.
Yeah. Where'd you get the trees? Who'd you order them through?
The vast majority of the trees I've gotten have been bare root stock through the state of Minnesota. They've helped me on cost shares with buying trees and cages. This is the natural regen bur oak. Bur oak do good in here. They do good in even the lower areas. They do good in red clay. People say they grow real slow, but if they're in the right place, they grow faster than you think. There's a lot of natural regen of bur oak around here. As far as my success rate with the trees, I've had good luck with both bare root and container stock. A couple, 3 years, I was doing 90-95%. I was really impressed. And last year I had a bad year. I think I only had about 60%. And I replanted those this fall. That was sort of a freak event, I think. I don't know if it's the conditions. I've had basically very good success with my planting. I plant my trees as soon as possible. I like it when I can use the planting bar and I open it up and water runs in the hole. In fact, last year there was some places where I had to sort of pound through an inch of frost to get them in. I try to get done before the bugs come out. I schedule everything by what Mother Nature will allow me to do. You know, I don't fight it anymore. I used to fight it. I just like being out, so I like to improve things. I've always been like this. When I was like in sixth grade, my buddies were out water skiing and I was planting trees. I'm thinking, there's something wrong with you. You find your interest in life, and this is my interest, you know, just to make things a little bit better. So it is beautiful. I don't know, I'm 66 years old. My wife said I'm gonna have to live to be 200 years old to do all this, but it keeps me going.
So I'm looking through here and I'm seeing a lot of standing snags here that were left. Can you kind of explain why?
Well, I left these snags basically for habitat, woodpeckers basically. I had a pileated woodpecker's nest back here every spring. There's a lot of wildlife here. I'd recommend anybody that's willing to prove their property for the future generations or what or for you to contact the NRCS because they've been very, very good to work with. They're very helpful and they can give you a lot of ideas and give you a lot of support. My two daughters live on this property. We designed it so they live on the edges of the property, and this trail starts at one daughter's house and ends up at the other daughter's house. And then the core of the property, like where we are now, will be more of the recreation area for the whole family. My two daughters were their husbands and five grandkids here, so everybody uses this trail system and this area for picnicking and snowshoeing and hiking and biking. That area right there, the gray, that's your balsam killed from the budworm. That's what this whole area looked like when we started. Some of the areas, it was 100% dead balsam. There was nothing left after I cut the balsam down. But most areas, it was scattered. It was scattered like that, so it's a tremendous fire hazard. When I burn, a lot of people just make this big monster pile and then try to burn it later after it's rained, and it's a disaster. Sometimes I've done that. You end up tearing it all apart again. So what I do is I'll cut out a certain area and start a small pile, and then I'll light that, and then I'll just keep feeding it. That way you don't get these big, huge burn areas. When I was 21 years old, I worked for a guy in my very first job logging in the woods, and this happened to be his skidder. It's a 1972, we bought it brand new, and my first job was running this skidder when I was 21. I'm 66 now. This guy came to be sort of a mentor for me and one of the guys I most respected in life. And he ran this skidder till he was 95 years old. At the end, he was just using it for his own firewood. And for a 72, it's in beautiful shape. I'm really proud of this skidder. This is it for me. First of all, you don't see many cable skidders anymore. It's got a winch on the back so I can pull trees in. But it's got a diesel engine, so it has lots of power. This one works perfect for my use because I can run around these white pines and stuff without scarring everything up. And then I just had that rake put on. It fit on here perfect. This works absolutely fantastic for me. I'd be lost without the skidder, simple as that. I don't get any better than this. This is my daughter's property, you know. She lives on the same large piece of property. It's 5 acres. Her and my son-in-law also have a NRCS equipped cost share. My two son-in-laws are working out here today with me. They cut and they keep me really hopping. They're cutting all the dead balsam down, and then they'll cut it up in pieces so I can work around with the skidder and get them into the pile.
For the past 5 or 6 years, I've been helping Jim on his property, and all this 10-acre pieces are 10 acres. All this dead balsam here, it's all dead because that spruce budworm is just killing it. You can see how there's hardly a green pine needle up there because it's all dead. So we're cutting it down. We cut it down to 8-foot lengths. And then Jim comes with the skidder and pushes it into the brush pile and burns it, gets rid of it. This area that we're working here is kind of an ash swamp, so we're cutting some of the ash too that is dying. We're going after cutting all the balsam and the spruce. The balsam and the spruce are these, the balsam are the flat needles, spruce are needles all the way around. It's mostly, we're in kind of a low area, so that's most of what's growing through here. Otherwise, there's some ash trees you can tell different from the bark. And we get a little bit of maple in here as well that you can tell. So we try to stay away from those. and really focus on the standing dead balsam spruce. We'll come back and replant kind of a variety of things. We try to plant what we know grows well up here. So white pine does really well. The lower areas we'll plant black spruce. Occasionally we'll put in a little bit of birch, but try to mirror the kinds of things that we do see around here that grow well.
Believe it or not, it's lucky that it was 2 below 0 the other day, that it froze the lower areas enough so we can get in and do it, so we can finish it up. We want to get it done before we get snow and stuff too, so it's a lot easier if we don't have to fight with the snow. When you get in the lower area, there's a lot of trees that are laying on the ground that are frozen the ground, and that makes it a little rough, but on the whole, it's gone really, really well. We should finish up this 5 acres, maybe even tonight or tomorrow morning, and we'll be all done with this 5 acres. And then I see some of my grandkids are out here today too, which is sort of nice. It's all about them, you know.
One of the fun things about being able to work back on the property is we occasionally get visitors. That's my brother-in-law's wife and kids. We're just back here. Our dog was wandering around back here. We're lucky to be able to live back where we do near family, and family's interested and wants to come out and see what's going on. My father-in-law, Jim, is really the mastermind here, and I think even though he worked construction for probably 30 years, he's always been a forester at heart, and he's got a passion for being out here, a passion for making land better than it is right now, and he's really trying to instill that in the rest of us, so it's fun to be out here with him.
You know, I've had people, even my friends, say, why are you doing all this? So I guess the reason that is it's twofold. One, of course, is the fire prevention, because my two daughters live on this land, and I've seen what has happened to other areas, been with these balsam in other parts of the country, the fires. So fire prevention was a big one, but it's also, sounds sort of corny, but it's sort of a legacy thing for me too, because I'm not a short-term person. A lot of people think short-term now, because I've had people say, well, why are you doing this? Because you're not going to live long enough to see these big trees. I says, well, but it's not about me. It's about the future generations, no matter who they are. Someday some people walk through here and really enjoy this, and they won't know I had a lot to do with it, but that doesn't matter. So this is all I can do. I can't write a book. I'm not a movie star except for here. And so this is my thing.